Hey everyone, JagTagger93 here. I know I'm set to stream Code Veronica in just a little bit. I need to rant though. I'm not gonna be. I apologize. I'm gonna tell you right now. I'm not gonna be avoiding spoilers, and I'm trying to be as objective as possible in my ranting. But I'm gonna be straight up with you. It's gonna sound like a lot of bitching and whining. That's gonna come across, because the Scream franchise is a set of movies that I really, really liked. And I even liked the TV shows. Well, most of them. The first two seasons on MTV were great. The third MTV season was... if you know, you know. But Scream 1, classic. Amazing. It's especially amazing when you know the ending and know who the killers are. And then you watch it again. You see that connection between Billy and Stu throughout the movie, and how they kind of toy with the other characters too. Like, there's that one great scene with I'm gonna forget names because I'm just so right now, but there's that one great scene with Jamie Kennedy's character, Randy, in the movie store with Billy and Stu. That's great. Billy, you're meant to think is innocent, and for the most part on the surface he seems like a red herring, but innocent character. But there's that side that you wonder about him. And Stu does seem to have like a maniacal thing. So when revealed as the killers, yes, there is a twist. Yeah, you know, Billy has his "we all go a little mad sometimes" moment, psycho. But it's believable, and it's good. And Billy has a motive too. And Stu's motive, which is simple, but effective too. Peer pressure. That. You know, you're stretching a little bit, but that's a little believable, too. But it was a great, great movie. The killer reveal was great. Excellent. But Scream 2022, I'm fucking pissed. I am so mad. The thing is, people are coming out of that movie going, meh, it was okay. And I'm like, motherfucker. No, it was not okay. Did we see the same movie? I don't know where to begin. The thing is, I didn't go in wanting to hate the movie. I didn't. I actually really liked Scream 4. I was really excited to see where the franchise was going. And it started promising. There's little things in Scream 2022 that are very interesting if they just followed up on them or did something with them. So, again, I'm not avoiding spoilers, so my spoiler-free review of Scream 2022 is very simply that they introduce a new cast of characters who do seem very interesting on the surface, and you want to feel invested in them, but all their screen time, especially in the middle of the movie, is taken away from them by the older characters that they just bring in that really feel shoehorned in, completely shoehorned in. So when they come back to these new characters at the end of the movie, you barely have any connection with them. You barely remember their names. When the killers are revealed, you're like, wait, who were you again? What's your motivation? Why are you doing this? You really give no fucks. And then the movie's on autopilot for that last portion, where they pretty much recreate most of the beats to the ending of Scream 1. I'm not kidding. They do a lot of the same scenes, a lot of the same shots, a lot of the same setups with characters and where they are in the house, in Stu's house too, just like in Scream 1, and they present it as fan service, but it just reeks of convenience, absolute convenience, and laziness. They're copying the screenplay, essentially, from the first movie, but presenting like, oh, isn't it quirky? It's the remake, we're meta. No, but fuck off. Fuck off. Give me something new. Fuck. Anyway, that's my spoiler-free review. The returning characters, Sydney, Gale, and Dewey, they're wasted. The newer characters are wasted as well. In the newer characters, the ones that you care probably the most about are completely wasted. And the ones that carry the movie are the ones that seem the most flat. And there, that's it for now. I'm getting into spoiler territory. So, The beginning of the movie starts with... Fuck, I don't remember these characters' names. Shit. A girl getting a phone call from someone asking who's her favorite scary movie and whatnot, and it's the killer. And the killer says, we're going to play a game, answer questions about the first Stab movie. If you get the questions right, your friend, Amber, see, I remember that character's name because I immediately called it. I was like, that's going to be one of the killers. Your friend Amber's going to die, and there's a phone recording them or being or shown there. But I'm thinking, okay, if the killer is with Amber, then this person is not in any danger. But that seems uncharacteristic for a Scream movie. Usually the character you see at the very beginning, again, the phone call, is in danger, so the killer should be there. Granted, there could be more than one killer, and of course there was, but still, I was thinking, now, how much you want to bet that Amber is actually recorded herself, you know, brushing her hair or whatnot, and sent it to this friend? I'm just going to pull it up on IMDb, because I'm going to be really annoyed not knowing these characters' names. I saw this last night, Scream 2022 cast. Let's see, again, this is very off the cuff. Wasn't Tara. It was Sam. I knew it was Sam. I didn't know if it was Sam was the older sister or the younger sister. Anyway, Sam's getting this phone call from Amber. And, Sam is attacked by Ghostface because she gets the questions wrong. She, is asked, you know, who was the protagonist in Stab? Who were the killers? And she mentioned Billy Loomis, but didn't mention Stu. And that makes Ghostface come out. And he stomps on her leg, very brutal, actually. It looks like it's right on her Achilles tendon, actually, so she can't walk. Is stabbing her, but not fatally, but stabbing her, and the police show up. And I'm thinking, okay, this is going to be interesting. We're starting the movie with one of the killers, maybe just a straight-up copycat, in prison, and this is going to cause things to unfold in Westboro. Interesting, we're starting with a killer copycatting the first scene in the Stab movie, well, Scream movie, already in prison. We'll see where this goes. I'm into this. No. Even though the police show up and the sirens are showing on the Ghostface mask, the killer just escapes somehow. The police are completely inept in this movie. Like, we've seen inept cops before. We've seen worthless police before in horror movies. But these police officers are fucking not... Even not in the movie. I mean, they're there, but at the least convenient times. They go out of their way to be completely bumbling, actually. So the new characters are introduced, and they do seem interesting, but they're wasted. One character that was, I thought, would be really interesting would be... Mindy and Chad Meeks, their twin siblings. Mindy is presented as the new Randy. She's really into horror movies. She's, of course, related to Randy, you know, nephew or something like that. And she's, you know, hyper aware of the horror movies, the Stab movies and whatnot. And she's like, don't you know what's going on? This is a remake or, you know, a requel, whatever. And she's all in the terminology. And that's all good, but... The thing with Randy that made him his character work and made his character endearing was he was aware of the rules of horror movies and saw them around him and was paranoid because of it and constantly scared for his well-being and the well-being of others. That made him, he gave a fuck. It's kind of hard to give a fuck about characters that don't give a fuck. And the thing with, I already forgot her name, I gotta look at it again. Meeks. What the fuck was it? Shit. Chad. Mindy. The thing about Mindy was she just gave no fucks. Gives absolutely no fucks throughout the entire movie. She's making jokes when people are dying. When they have the party at Stu's house, she's there. She's getting high. She's making out with people. She gives no fucks. When her brother, Chad, goes off on his own, she doesn't give a shit. I'm like, bitch, if you were Randy, if you were really Randy, Randy would be flipping his shit right now. What the fuck are you doing partying in Stu's house in a remake scenario? Your brother's going off on his own. People are leaving. People are dying around you. This is not safe. This is not a good place to be. Why are you in the same position as Randy? Granted, Randy did survive the first movie, but you know what happened in the second movie? Stop trying to wake up and smell the coffee. Fuck. So, her character is wasted just because she just seems so carefree the entire time. It's like, hello, look what's happening around you. This pissed me off. One character I felt really invested in, if nothing else, just for the name, Wes. There's a character named Wes, obviously a reference to Wes Craven. And he dies. He dies, and of course, when he dies, his last words to Ghostface, the killer, is fuck you. And I find that so fitting. I find that so, so fitting that his last words, the last words of Wes to this new Ghostface, this new franchise, this new turn that the franchise took, was fuck off. Right? And of course they kill off Wes. And of course they rub it in that Wes is dead in the party. They all say, yeah, for Wes, and all drinking at Wes. Fuck off. Pisses me off. Where else do I want to go? Shit, I could talk about the killers. Deputy Judy Hicks, Wes's mom, also dies. And that sucked because, again, you feel invested in characters, and the movie punishes you for feeling invested in them. So Ghostface is threatening her son, her baby boy, and she's hightailing it back to her house, calling all the police to show up. And again, the police are fucking worthless. They don't show up for shit. Calling the police to show up to get there. And of course, she runs right into Ghostface's knife and is killed for, you know, giving a shit about her son. And then her son dies right after. I was really hoping that at least one of them would survive that encounter. Either Wes or Wes's mom, Sheriff Judy Hicks. If one of them survived, that would give them more of a motivation to want to find the killer. Instead of stuff just happening around these characters. Fuck. So, when people are dying, the cast, Sam, the older sister of Tara, reaches out to the survivors of Westboro in the first movie, Stab or Scream, whatever, Gail, and Dewey, and Sydney. And Dewey, feeling motivated to protect these girls like how he wanted to protect his sister, a good callback to the first movie, saddles up again and tries to help him find the killer. Unfortunately, he gets Han Solo'd for his troubles, Star Wars Episode 7. He dies in a very obvious setup, and it was fucking horrible. He shoots Ghostface quite a few times in the chest. Ghostface kills over. He takes Tara, who is wounded in the hospital, and Sam into an elevator, make sure they're safe, and goes back to finish off Ghostface. All well and good. This is smart. Yes, you have the killer down. You have a gun. Finish him. Or her. It's actually going to be her, as we'll see later. Finish her off. And that's what he intends to do. However, as he's walking over to Ghostface, I'm realizing, oh no, you're going to die. Because I hate when people, when they have a ranged weapon, forget that they have a ranged weapon. He gets super up close, point blank, perfect stabbing distance, and dies for his trouble. And of course, they're fighting before this happens. They're going back and forth. And I'm thinking, oh my god, this Ghostface character is a tank. It took bullets. Granted, it could be wearing Kevlar, but even if you're wearing Kevlar, if you get shot in close range, you're still gonna be hurt. You could break a rib very easily. You know, you're gonna need a bit. And this person is muscling with adults, actually. And holding their ground. I mean, yeah, they do take a beating, but they get right back up. They're durable as all fuck. Who the hell is this killer? So I thought for sure the killer was going to be one of the killers. I thought one, again, was going to be Amber, and the other one was going to be the father of Tara and Sam. Now, I didn't even mention that part yet, but the actual real father of Tara and Sam was Billy Loomis, but they were raised not knowing him. They were raised with their mom's boyfriend, who raised them as if he was their father. Sam found out the truth. It broke this man's heart. I thought that he would have come back into the movie, would have been the other killer. But no. The killer was Amber, I called it. And Sam's boyfriend, what the fuck, Richie. And the one doing most of the stabbing, apparently, the one that definitely killed Dewey, because she said she did, was Amber, this petite 90-pound high school kid, murdered this former sheriff. And granted, Dewey did fall on hard times, but it wasn't very believable. And what's even more not believable is her motive. Amber is a character that I only remember her name because of the phone, the texting, the thing at the beginning of the movie. I completely forgot she was in the movie. Yeah, she kept showing up, but I kept forgetting about her. I couldn't tell you a shit about what she liked to do or who she hung out with or anything. So when she had her "we all go a little mad sometimes" moment by pulling out the gun and shooting, I was like, what? I felt more of a connection to the elevator dude from the movie White Noise. And if you know what I'm talking about, shout outs to you. The killer in that movie was just some random dude in an elevator. When Amber's one of the killers, I'm like, okay, you're random as fuck. You had no character, hardly any lines that I remember, no personality. Okay, the second killer better be good. And it was the boyfriend. Just because he wanted a remake of Stab. That was his motivation. And the boyfriend character is into horror movies too. But it doesn't feel believable. When Billy was made to be the character, Billy was believable because you saw that dark side, and yeah, he had more of a motivation to him, besides just wanting to make a scary movie. But no, the sole motivation here for Amber and Richie, was that they actually wanted to make a remake of the Stab movies, and they thought by doing this they'd get the remake. That was it. And I didn't even know if Richie and Amber were even that close. I don't remember them really directly talking to each other or having much of a connection with each other. Again, with Billy and Stu, it was believable because they did seem like that they were close together, right? And the characters in the movie just give absolutely no fucks. People around them are dying, and they still have a party anyway. Granted, in the first movie, people were dying, but the people that were dying weren't really part of the circle of friends. I mean, you did have Drew Barrymore's character, who kind of sort of knew the circle of friends. But when the principal dies, you know, a bunch of other kids in the high school, it's a big high school, they're at the party, right? So it's a little bit more believable than here. When someone directly in their circle of friends, Wes and her mom, his mom, dies, they all go to the party anyway. I mean, granted, Sam and Tara aren't there by choice because they went there to look for Sam's inhaler. I really thought the inhaler thing would be much more of a Chekhov's gun because he kept calling back to it, but not really. Really, Richie had the inhaler on him the whole time, and he just wanted to get them back in Stu's house to remake the movies. And again, things flow more or less like how they do in the original, just without the heart or the intelligence. And again, one other part that was interesting was Sam constantly being visited with images of Billy Loomis. Like, he's appearing to her like he's a force ghost, actually. It's kind of funny. I do like that one cool moment where Billy, you know, motions at her to take a knife to defend herself. I thought that was kind of neat. Towards the end of the movie, but still, this idea of her having a dark side, I would have liked it if she felt compelled to violence this whole time. And it would be a much better movie if that first Ghostface killer was caught as a copycat, and there's all these triggering things for this person suffering from this trauma, and that ends up being the tipping point, and they're struggling to hold back. You could have a very good internal struggle there, but that's just kind of an afterthought, really, in this movie. This Billy Loomis force ghost just seems like a way to have another returning character in the movie. I let out a few audible. I tried to be quiet, but in the theater. But I did let out a few audible fuck offs during the movie. They had one line: "You can't have a Halloween movie without Jamie Lee, right?" I'm like, fuck off. No, you can. Go in a new direction. Because, you know what? Halloween fans like myself, a lot of the Halloween movies we really like didn't have Jamie Lee Curtis in it. Don't get me wrong, Halloween 1 and 2 are classics, they're amazing. But a lot of Halloween fans love 4 as well, and 4 did not have Jamie Lee in it, okay? Five is underrated. You know, six, you know what I mean. But a lot of people out there really liked Halloween 3 as well for being original. I'm not one of them, but I respect their opinion because it was original. And I can respect when a movie does something original. What I don't respect is when a movie panders to fans and is so out of touch with what they think fans want. This movie was pandering. It shoehorned in Gale, Sidney, and Dewey. They took up so much screen time and robbed screen time from the central cast. They hurt the film. They really did. Such a waste. Characters were introduced just to be brushed aside very quickly with hardly any... just to be a red herring, I guess, for maybe 2 seconds. Like, there's this one... This one unsavory individual that is, like, giving eyes to, I think, Liv was her name. One of the other teens, whatever. And him and Chad have beef. He ends up getting killed by Ghostface just because. I don't know. There might have been some relation there. Because it seemed like in this movie, everyone of the main cast knew or was a relative of someone in the original Stab movie. Well, Scream movie. You know what I mean? The original Westboro Massacre. It felt kind of like Nightmare on Elm Street in that regard, where they were like the Elm Street kids. They could have gone more with that and did detective work to figure out who was next and try to see, you know, it would be really interesting if they realized the killer is going in order of relation. And then, you know, they could have done so much more. But instead, they copy-pasted from the original, presented as fan service, said, you should be happy, enjoy, we brought back the original cast, aren't you happy? And I said, fuck off. No. No, Scream 2022 is dead. The franchise is dead to me right now at this point. I feel much better after getting that out. If you were listening for the entire 20 minutes, I thank you. If you listened for just 2 minutes and turned me off, you were like, nah, this guy's just going to bitch. Cool, that's fine too. Either way, I look forward to playing some Code Veronica in a little bit. And thanks for hearing me rant. I feel a lot better now. I feel like I can stream with a cooler head. Thanks.